small introduction into open source communities a little bit, but I feel a little bit overwhelmed because we also already came from Leslie's talk, which was very awesome. I only have a few things to mention about open source communities in general, and then it's me again. And I have some things, you know, about the structure of the Type 3 community. So I would just invite you, you know, that we have some kind of a conversation about that, and just see, you know, at a certain point, if we if there's something that we can discuss about it, and just let's keep it a little. On the light side, and if there's anything you know that you think, okay, this might come up, this is really a question I have, let's engage in it and see what we can do. So, oh wait, all right. So, I have been community manager for I think the last 4 years in the Type 3 community, and. It's interesting always to with every presentation, what's exactly my background. And I found out, you know, when preparing this, and I thought, okay, I've done now this 20, I don't know how many presentations, and every time it's something different I can use from my past, which is interesting in whatever presentation we have. So for this for this presentation, I thought, my background is that I love my wife, and I love my kids, and it's the community day, so for me that's the background, and that's today most important. The nice thing is that when I became a community manager, or at least I was asked at a certain point, this might be interesting for you, Brian, because we kind of we discussed it. How is this going to be? Maybe for the Joomla community, at a certain point, our community grew so big, so many different projects going on that. At a certain point, we had Casper, you know, of course, which was the guy that created Type 3. We didn't have him anymore. There were so many people, and we recognized there were so many projects going on, and simultaneously also. So we then. We did, but we didn't have anybody that has the bigger picture. And as it was very convenient at that time, I incidentally had a burnout from my from the company I was working in. And that was quite convenient because I left my company, and I had in the previous years, you know, when I had my company, from the beginning I was doing community manager work already. So. Maybe that's similar to what you do, Brian. I don't know. I don't know you that well already, but from the first day I joined the community, so I'm no developer at all. But from the first day, I started writing documentation or working with some guys. Oh, we need this for the CMS. So that's the kind of stuff that I had been doing for all the time. And one of the major things what I did as a community as a participant of the community. Was to make sure that we had a good HTML output, and or XHTML output. So these, I always like to tell these things, you know, because we're in such a developer-oriented community that there's so much else to do. So I've been doing this for 4 years now, and so in the beginning when I started this, I didn't know even know. I never heard of a community manager. What actually am I? Was it the product manager? I actually printed my first business cards which said product manager, but pretty soon already, I thought, okay, I'm not a technical guy, so I would never be the product manager. So after Googling a little bit, then I found out, okay, there's such a thing as community manager. Now actually, for the past 3 years, I go to the Community Leadership Summit in Portland, where we have tons of community managers. Well, you come there next time too, Brian. So this is really awesome. This is the first summit conference I ever went to, which have a 50-50 ratio of men-women. How awesome is that? Really nice people, and there's really a lot to learn, because also in community management, you know, which is really based on soft skills, there's a lot of stuff going on. There's also trends in community management. So I think one of the things that's currently very important is, or maybe it's always important, is how do you measure community metrics? And that's something I can really learn a lot from other community managers, how, what kind of tools do they use for measuring community. So interesting. I'm currently the only one that's on a semi full-time budget. It's a 75% budget that I currently get. And so that's what I'm doing for the past 4 years. And as a result of being a community manager, I'm also doing community management on a local scale. That was very interesting. When I had some meetings in my neighborhood, people said, hey, you're a community manager. We can use you in our local, some urban planning stuff. And I have a community I'm specifically proud of, and that's the skate hall, which I do for the past year, which is also really, really nice to manage all the skate kits. I unfortunately don't have a picture of that, but if you follow me somewhere, then you will regularly see some images of that. So, one of the things that also really, that's the last thing I wanted to mention about community manager is what really surprised me is if you currently scout around on LinkedIn or wherever, it's the hottest job around, community manager. I could never imagine when I started this, you know, having soft skills and saying to people you've done a good job, or you know, lifting them to another level or helping out somewhere, that it would ever be such a wanted job. I mean, we are currently, I think, in society in a phase where we can use the power of community of open source to help local communities out. So, for me, that was really an amazing thing to see. So. A little bit about the open source communities is about one of the, what I find, and at least that's something that's in the Type 3 community currently very important, and that's communication and trust. We can never communicate too much, you know, and what we really need is to trust each other in the things that we do. And I've been thinking about it the last couple of days, because I also did this presentation in Poland, but then with a totally different approach. And I've been thinking, how do we communicate? How can we or measure or see how we communicate properly? So what we have in the Type 3 community is a code of conduct, which we kind of derived from the Ubuntu code of conduct. And that kind of describes, you know, how that we deal with each other with respect and all these things that we see are important for us, but we sometimes seem to forget. Still, in the Type 3 community, it's very difficult if we're in a discussion to say to someone, please go and read the community code of conduct. That's still a difficult thing, but I'm trying to work towards, I'll show you a little later, on a kind of community working group where that kind of guides the community using these principles. Yesterday or the day before, we had a question from one of the WordPress people, you know, that asked about, we also want to implement a code of conduct. And so they were interested in our code of conduct, but I said it's based on the Ubuntu code of conduct. So in between, and trust is something I would say, you know, that when we're talking about our community, We have a certain key value, which is inspiring people to share. And sharing is inherently something, you know, what you do based on trust. So I would say these things, you know, sometimes if there's we have things going on in the community, sometimes step back. Communication-wise, we can have a look at the code of conduct. And regarding trust, I would say just look at exactly what is our community meant to do. Is that, Brian, is that also something that you in the Joomla community have, or that you could really point out?
Yeah, we stole our code of conduct from Ubuntu.
Yeah.
With that permission.
Yeah. Yeah, of course.
Well, we told them we were stealing it. So yeah. Didn't you mind?
I think the Ubuntu Code of Conduct is being used by many open source projects. Actually, this is Brian. You've got a bit of the same function as I have, right, in the Joomla community?
Without title.
Yeah. Well, we can officially officially name you. I mean, you don't necessarily have to be paid to be called a community manager. So, in between communication and trust. And we have especially, I think some things that we, you know, as a community really need to rely on. That's a certain ideology. And we really have to move sometimes between the business perspective, I'm looking at you, and with the things that we as a community or as a social environment try to achieve. So there's a number of things, you know, like the norms we have. What do we believe in? We believe in open source and the values. And what I'm trying to achieve, I hope, especially this year, to get some focus on our values. And I think if you have the chance, I would recommend you to go to the Niels talk. I think it's today where they're really very strong in defining their values. So next to being awesome programmers, they also talk a lot about what does it mean, you know, to be in the Niels team. This is something, I think they do a lot of innovative work in the NEOS team that will adapt for the whole Type of 3 project. So I also came across, so for me, this whole picture kind of paints already the kind of pillars, you know, of an open source community, of our community. And sometimes, you know, the effectiveness, some of the bodies like the board really want to see how effective is the community. Sometimes this is so difficult, and sometimes I also really like to forget that we work with Type 3, because I really like, you know, that we have our community. And when talking about effectiveness, how effective are we? How quickly can we develop Type 3? Sometimes, for me, this is really, sometimes it's on the background. It's very difficult to say, you know, how, if we only focus on effectiveness, you know, how can we stimulate people? I mean, we cannot really tell them, you know, you need to be effective. I think the first thing is what I'll also show in the Pecha Kucha in the afternoon. It's a very short presentation about how we need to care about each other. So, about communication, it's a very nice example, and which I really like you to pay close attention to, which can go awfully wrong. So we, for the past years, we get really a lot of channels we can communicate on. I mean, if we open our laptops, we have Skype, we have Hangout, we have Facebook, we have Twitter. There's so much to communicate on, but it doesn't mean that our communication gets a lot more effective. I really do like what Google is doing with the current Hangouts. I think that's being able to communicate with the group. That's, I think, very effective, and it can also convey their emotions a little more. So this is an example I use in several presentations, and this is goes mainly about written communication, or in mail, or in Skype. And this one little sentence, which you can interpret in so many different ways. So if you could say, I didn't say he was stupid. I didn't say he was stupid. I didn't say, instead of I didn't write. And I didn't say he was stupid. Now you can see already, you know, that you have this small sentence. I mean, you probably everyone knows probably this the thing happening, you know, in your communication, how you yourself interpret things like this, and then. We have a white screen. No. That's really remarkable communication-wise. This was supposed to be a Polish slide in Polish. And where I wanted to show, you know, that we communicate in the same language, but what about, you know, communicating with guys in a totally different country? I've been to Poland last week, and sometimes I would try to really to be careful. Am I not doing something stupid? You know, it's, I mean, Poland's quite close, but sometimes you can do really something culturally not okay. And the nicest example of miscommunication that was in the presentation at OSCOM had last with us last year was about this question about bike sharing. You know, and the question on the forum: what color shall we paint our bike shed? And someone reacted in the forum saying we paint it blue. And the reaction in the forum was on the other side: why are you being always such an asshole? Only for the remark of blue. So this means that we have in our minds a lot of interpretation that we already have an idea of what the other person is like. You know, what he only the answer blue, and it's a bit of an exaggeration, but it can already trigger the response. Why are you always being such an asshole? So sometimes we in communication. And we really need to step back a little and assume always the best intent for people, or just easily just pick up the phone and talk to someone. So I'd like to wrap up this section, you know, about the open source communities in general, and saying that social capital is our capital. This is, I think in any community. I'm not daily into other communities, but I know from the Type 3 community that money is sometimes a topic, you know, the budget discussions, who should get budget. We had a whole discussion going on recently about paid development. And then the focus is really on the money side of this thing. But once again, we need to really to take care and look at this. Social capital is our capital. That's very important. So is there anything, you know, someone has any question, you know, regarding communication in general in open source communities, or you know, would like to raise a topic or say anything else? All right. So let's just quickly go on to the Type 3 community itself. And then I'll explain a little bit, you know, what the structure is of the Type 3 community, and maybe you can have some questions on how to participate in the Type 3 community. So it is rather unfortunate that we have no one from the association in this room. The current association, I think after this talk there will also be a presentation about what's going on with the board. Everyone's at Simon Phipps' talk, which is also a very important topic. So what we currently have is a division. The board has always been there, so they basically do the boring work. Sometimes we said, guys, if you do the boring work, then don't do it. But they do the legal, financial stuff, you know, checking out, does someone violate the brand. So the expert advisory board is something that we have as a new body. And I used to be in the steering committee that we had for years when we started the association. So basically, the association was started to make sure that development of Type 3 continued, so that there would be funds, etc. So the board was there, and we at a certain point decided there should be a steering committee or whatever this was called. This was basically just a kind of old boys network. I was there for a couple of years, the last 2 years. And this were people like Robert Lemke, the original, some of the original guys that started the association. No, we're there already for such a long time. We're in the steering committee, but we had a lot of criticism about what about transparency, about the strategy, and so there was at a certain point a meeting where it was decided, okay, we'll create. When we create something new, we always give it a new name, but this could easily just also have been called steering committee, but now we call it expert advisory board. These people were chosen from the members in some kind of a poll, and what their function is to decide on the budgets and give advice to the board. There's a lot of controversy going on about the expert advisory board, and I can only say one thing is that the thing is what you get with voting is that you get a political body immediately. So there's still a tension between what the association actually is doing for the community and what the community does for the community itself. So we have to see. I mean, we need, from the association, we need a proper budget planning. This is something that the actual advisory board does in a very good way. But there are also some things, you know, which I personally believe being a political body has certain disadvantages. We also have a business control committee, which basically checks my invoices or other invoices. So why it's a pity that no one from the association is here. This, I did this same talk when I was in the steering committee 4 or 5 years ago. And what we really tried to explain, and like 4 or 5 years ago, this was really not clear to the community at large or to any of the participants of the conference, that the Type 3 Association was meant to fertilize the project, you know, to make it going, to give some financial input somewhere. But at the same time, it's a little bit smelly. But still, nothing has changed in that sense. So I don't know, you know, it's just like you choose your own government, but there's always something fishy going on. So this is a bit of a controversy, difficult thing. The community, by accident, when I created my presentation, I added individuals at the top of a long list that will be here, but then I thought I'll just leave it like this, because if there's one thing that a community is, then it's individuals. That might seem a bit strange, because we're always very proud of, we have these awesome teams and that make up the Type 3 community, but I would say that basically it's all about individuals. And even if you look at the teams, then some efforts that are being done in a team are largely an individual effort. You also know, Petra, that Joey does a lot by himself. I mean, it's not really like, okay, there will be a code sprint once in a while, but he will be crazy working evenings all by himself. And I mean, we see this in the community a lot. There are these guys, you know, that exactly like Casper started Type 3, lock them up, themselves up for a couple of months and then get shit done. I think that's what a very good example is. This is the nameless coder. I don't know if anyone knows it. You know him probably. We have one of the, that's the guy that does the Fluid implementations. He's a crazy. He's a Dane, right or not? Yeah, and he's incredibly productive. He creates the yeah. At least what I hear, I never use it myself, but I hear from lots of people, so lots of appreciation for this. He's a loner because he never comes to conferences, and he just gets shit done. And sometimes I think it's remarkable, because if you look at the development of Type 3 NEOS, and of course we use totally different paradigms now to develop software, but we have a core team of 25 people currently, and not a final product. I mean, years of work with so many people, and undoubtedly we'll have a very good result, of course, but sometimes it's really amazing to see what one person can do. So what we have currently, it is also a really a nice topic for discussion. For me personally, I really love what's going on currently. We have awesome stuff going on in the NEOS branch, so to speak. And we are currently also in the phase, you know, where we kind of let go that NEOS would be the direct successor of Type 3 CMS, which as a result also means that the developers get more freedom just to continue the work they are doing on Type 3 CMS. How this exactly will balance out, we'll have to see. No one can look into the future, I would say, because we all kind of expected 3 years ago that this would be the way things go. But the thing is, what I also have as a community manager is that you need to go to ride on the flow of things that are happening. So that means, you know, if developers want to work on a certain system, I need to enable them, or as a community, we need to enable them to do their work. And I would be the last person to say to someone, no, don't work on this product, go and work on that product. So we have two core teams currently. The nice thing is that I won't say there's a very tight cooperation yet, but a lot of innovation from Flow Neos goes back into CMS, which is already happening for a lot of years already. And the nice thing is that there was in the presentation of Leslie, there was a mention of how can we spread leadership. But what I try to do currently is that I have a community contact point in the Type 3 CMS, which is Benny Mack, and in Type 3 Flow, which is Christian Muller. And we have some kind of bi-weekly meetings discussing what's going on that level. So I also try to spread that leadership down a little bit. At the developer days, I also said in the presentation, it would be most awesome if I could teach everyone how to lead their teams and then leave the community, which I don't want to leave the community, but it would be my ideal if I could really show other people how to lead their teams or their parts of the community. So we have the other teams, which is design team, documentation, security events, editorial, type3.org. So there's a lot of room for people in the community, outside of the community, to participate in the work that needs to be done. So just a quick rundown of the state of the Type 3 community, and maybe some interesting things to come. We have this new product family, which I already explained a little bit about. The expert advisory board, which I also mentioned a little bit about budget decisions. We'll have to see, the guys are doing a lot, also with Simon Phipps who's doing the presentation now, of how and what the meaning of the expert advisory board will be. We have had some years of the social unrest, and which is not that strange. We really can accept that, and some people are really afraid, okay, we have this very negative things going on in the Type 3 community, it's not that bad. If it was 50%, then it would be really bad. But of course, there are always some people who are ultimately very critical. And that's also a good thing, I think, to wake us up from time to time. But I must say, honestly, this is kind of now everyone is kind of used to the change that we go to the family of products. Everyone's eased out a little bit. This is, I think, still incredible. I'm really wondering where this is going. In 2009, we had the first code sprint, the User Experience Week. And past year, we had 6 Type 3 camps and I think 9 code sprints. This has kind of doubled. It's amazing. I mean, for me personally, you would all say to me, that's really great that you travel so much, but I'm almost not home anymore. It's really crazy. So the Type 3 camps, we have the Type 3 in Poland, Romania, Mallorca, and all the camps in Germany. In the Netherlands, we also have one. I also sincerely hope that we have the developer days in the Netherlands next year. It probably will work. I hope so. The new organization of the European Type 3 conference, that's very interesting. I'm really interested in what people think about how they experience it. I would have really loved it if we would have had the double amount of visitors, which is not true. We have something like 325 people altogether. So I guess that we'll see an extra 100 people arriving tomorrow. It's specifically here for business. One thing that we realized is that we really should look into team communication. But how can we, I mean, that's basically the stuff that Leslie was talking about. So we'll have in 1 month a marketing workshop really focused on this team communication, how can we all be leaders, and get along together in a productive way. We'll have 1 day that we discuss strategy of the whole Type 3 community, and we'll have a number of days where we really work on products, folders. This is something, it's not the state of the Type 3 community yet, but a little bit already. But this is something that I would like to, and what I hear everywhere, to really need to focus on, is to innovate. And not innovate only because we really like to make new features, but the excitement of innovation, you know, the working together on some new stuff. And I cannot say enough to people, we are one of the oldest open source CMS systems around. We have the knowledge. We can do it. We can teach other people how to do it. So organizing it, to go around to that quickly. Community coordination, this is what I just mentioned. I have regular meetings with the guys from the core teams. I'm working on a community working group. I asked some people already, you know, would you be interested in such a thing? You know about this, Brian, community working groups? We can discuss this later. So this is something that we had focused on for quite some time already. A product group would mean a team meeting of all the important teams working on all our products. I hope that we, in summer in December, we can manage that. One of the other ideas is workshops combined with Type 3 camps. And innovate. Hey, how's that? Okay, thank you very much for your attention. Do we have some questions, possible?
What?
Do we have some time for questions?
No, actually. The next
it's no problem at all, because you can always, with many of you, I will probably discuss in the hallway. So thank you very much for your attention. And yeah, let's hear it. If you have any ideas or have any questions on how to do stuff, ask me. Thank you.
Please remember the part you can
just ask directly.
Sorry?
I will just ask directly.
Yeah.
You mentioned shitstorm and stuff like that.
Yeah.
How do you deal with that? How do you interfere or interact yourself?
Yeah,
or
no.
You kind of
step back. Stay hard on individual.